First, I want to explain a little bit about big data history, because yesterday I tried to explain it, but big data has been around for quite a long time. Big data, you could say that has been was created more than 10 years ago. And we started working with big data almost then, 9 years ago. But the big question still, after 9 years, is where should I use the big data technology? What is the use case? That is the big question for most of the companies. I am going to try to explain this or the answer to this question, because we are convinced that big data is not the best way to do the digital transformation, but it is the only way to do it, to really do it. So I will try to explain in this presentation why. So the first point is, what is digital transformation? And why all the companies, the big companies, are involved in some way in the digital transformation? Well, then I am going to answer three questions. Why, when, and what? What is digital transformation? So, why? I think most of the companies where you are working are involved in digital transformation. If you think seriously, most of your IT projects are through digital channels, mobiles, big data, and so on. So this is digital transformation. Maybe you don't have a global plan for digital transformation, but you have the projects to go through that path. So why to do this digital transformation? Well, the first point is that the world is digital. We are living in a global and digital world. So digital is reinventing not only how we work in our companies, but the human experience, how people live, how we play, how we connect together. We are in the connected society. We have more mobiles in Europe and US and all the most of the countries that people living. So we are really in the connected society. Digital is reinventing all human experience. So you can say with no doubt that we are in the age of customers. But what is the problem for the companies? The problem is, as you can see in these statistics, that customers are in control, completely in control. I will not read all of them, don't worry. But for example, a very satisfied customer will tell or will talk about you to 12 customers. Sorry, a dissatisfied customer, but a very dissatisfied customer will talk about you, and not well, of course, to 20. But a satisfied customer only will talk about you to 3. Because human people is more to criticize than to... This is sad, but it is like that. And 98% of dissatisfied customers never complain. They just leave. So, no doubt we are in the customer's age, but the real problem is this. Our customers are much more digitalized than the companies, the physical companies. If you count the digital devices that there is in any family at any home, you could say, okay, for example, my kid goes with the tablet to the school, so we have 2 tablets, 2 mobiles, 2 computers, like 6 to 8 devices. How many devices has a normal employee? 1 computer and maybe a mobile. So really, our customers are advancing in the digital world a lot faster than the companies are doing. So this is the gap between our customers here in the digital world and our companies long behind, really behind, being laggards. This gap is the problem and the reason to do this digital transformation. But This is not for us the only problem or that you should solve. As you have seen most of the talks yesterday, the one that Paco Nathan made in the keynote, we are in the beginning of the machine age. We are using machine learning to try to understand the data, and really, we are in the customer's age, but we are in this very complex intersection with the machine age. Why? Well, first, we are digitalizing the world. Most of the projects that we are doing are related to cameras, satellites, city, security, and so on. So really, it is sort of scary, but almost everything in the world is being digitalized right now, at this moment. Satellites. Sensors, IoT. Paco was explaining yesterday also that IoT is one of the big issues. IoT and M2M are generating right now 50 times more volume than all internet data together. And this is really huge quantities of data. Well, self-driving, these cars are sensing 50 times per second everything that is happening there and making pictures. So with this, you will have hundreds of no drivers sensorizing, digitalizing everything that is happening in the world. So really, this is self-driving industry, what they are interested in, or really, they are interested in having hundreds of millions of people digitalizing the streets, the cities, the countries, the world. Well, this is no doubt the goal. Wearables, all of us, we have, they are sensing what we are doing. Feelings, the Facebook experiment, bringing or sending sad or happy news to see what the customer were reacting to make more conversions. This is a classic. And of course, the customer's journeys are not defined now. We will have infinite points for the customer's journey. So really, we are in this, the customer age and the matching age. And this is the reason for the digital transformation. If you don't put the intelligence of machines, and here we are talking about, of course, data intelligence, machine learning, and the final goal, artificial intelligence, working together with the people, with our employees, in our companies, we will be left behind, and we will be disrupted. There is no doubt about that. So, after this, maybe it was a little bit apocalyptic, but I am going to increase the drama. Minor change ahead. Well, Paco yesterday was explaining that self-driving cars are not that advanced. Maybe we will have to wait for some years because of regulations, technology, and so on. But you could say that in 5 years, this will be a reality. So the Uber drivers, the taxi drivers, okay, the future is not uncertain. They will be unemployed. This is another, well, it's sort of funny, but the delivery guys, the boys in the motorbikes and so on, while these robots are doing the job already now in some US cities, much more efficiently than they do. And of course, the truck drivers, we are already experimenting with this. And I was explaining this in England 2 weeks ago, so I had to put, because of the English culture, this, a self-driving beer, is it a joke? No. Budweiser is doing, is experimenting with self-driving trucks already in the US. So this is where we are going. What all this mean? More than 500 million jobs will be lost in the next 5 years. And of course, another 100 of millions of jobs will be created. And if you think this makes sense, so there is no any reason to deny that this is our reality. So the digital transformation really is a need, but some of the answers of our customers, the CIOs, the CEOs, they say, okay, you know why really I have to do the digital transformation in my company? Well, I have to do it out of responsibility. Because if not, my company will have no future, but also my employees, my team will have no future. Where do you want to be? In the 500 million without jobs, or in the ones doing this transformation? So it is something out of responsibility to do this digital transformation for your people, because we don't want to fire people. We want our people to recycle to this digital world, okay? These are the some of the threats, the big digital companies, the startups, traditional competitors partnering with other sectors and others. These are some of the fintechs in the financial sector. The ecosystem is really scary. And so when to transform? I think now we understand why, but when? Well, two types of necessity. Surviving? No. You don't have to transform when there is something struggling for survive. In that, if that happens, you are already a zombie, and if you're a zombie, you are dead. You cannot revive. So this is not the right moment to do it. You have to do it when you are leading. Why? Well, because we all know all these companies and they were leading, but they didn't react. So the final conclusion for the when is when you are leading, add extinction and avoid extinction. There is nothing riskier than not taking risks, okay? So we know now the why, the when, and there is another question that normally people, the CEOs, the presidents, the boards, ask us when we are talking about this, about the apocalypse. They say, okay, but how to do it? Should that be an innovative company, innovation, or a follower? This is the typical question. Because to innovate is much more expensive than to follow. And we always say, at least you have to be a very, very fast follower. Why? Because technology evolution right now is exponential. These are some of samples that the board, CEOs, presidents, they consider these technologies like sort of cool. So we put these samples, but drones or DNA are good examples for technology. This is the evolution of the cost for these technologies in the last 5 years. In just 6 years, if you see the drones, the price of that technology went down to 1% of the initial cost. At the beginning, they were military technology. Right now, you can buy a pretty good one just with $700. In fact, after this talk, you can see a demonstration of a drone controlled with big data in our stand, in Stratio stand. So technology is evolving exponentially. And the DNA is another very good example. The first project was $2.7 billion, and the US government was behind. And right now you can make a DNA sequencing just for $1K. So really, technology is evolving exponentially. You cannot be a follower any longer. At least you must be a very, very fast follower. Otherwise, you will be a laggard. So I will not explain what is exponential because we don't have time. But I want to finalize this section with this. This is a classic. So the company that moves the most people in the world, of course, is not Boeing, it's not, you all know, it is right now Uber. How many cars Uber has? Zero. The company that reserves the most rooms, it is not NH, it is not Donald Trump, it is not. It is Airbnb. The same for music with Spotify. And this is not true any longer because now they are producing, but it was for Netflix, it was the same. So the new leaders, they have zero physical assets. They only have digital assets. And this means that the world is changing. No. The world has changed. But in our companies, the boards, some CEOs, presidents, they haven't realized that yet. So we have to convince them to move. Because my favorite saying is, software is eating the world. And this is our reality right now. Okay. I will go to what? We now know why, when to do it, but what is digital transformation? Because there is a lot of mumbo-jumbo about this digital transformation stuff, everybody's talking. We prefer to simplify things. So we make sort of a summary for digital transformation with three vectors. The first one, we are in the customer age, so digital transformation is all about customer centricity obsession. This is the first vector. Customer centricity is UX, user experience or design. Well, it's a part, but no. Customer centricity is adapt to your customer and evolve with him as fast as he is doing it. And in order to do that, you need data. You need behavior analytics. You need to analyze, to improve, to test things. You need machine learning. So the first point is customer centricity. Customer centricity obsession is not possible without data intelligence. The second is digital channels. Digital channels prioritizing mobile. Mobile is right now in most of the sectors the channel with more contacts from the customers, and in the sectors that is not the first channel, it is the one that is growing faster. So the second vector for digital transformation is digital channels prioritizing mobile. And the third, of course, is data intelligence, data-driven decisions, data intelligence. These are the three vectors for digital transformation. So we were analyzing what were doing the experts in digital, and we came to the next conclusion. We define the digital experts like digital dragons because, well, the reason is that they are like flying, and in 2,000 meters of altitude, they are attacking all the sectors. Doesn't matter which sector you are in, they are attacking that sector. So you are in fire. The question is big, your building is really like destroyed or sort of a small distraction, doesn't matter. All the sectors are jeopardized by this digital dragon. So the question is, what technology are they using? Because this is the how to do this digital transformation, these three vectors. And these are some of the questions, the answers that after 10 years trying and helping the big companies to do this, we found. The first one is big data. And you will say, okay, we are in a big data event, so no doubt, big data. But for us, big data doesn't complement previous technologies. And this is it is not a mistake, but it is that we are using big data, not getting all the value of big data. Of course, it is good to complement previous technologies with big data, because you will get some of the value of big data. But the dragons are not using a host, and they are not using Oracle. They are using big data for everything. So you don't complement previous technologies with big data. You replace previous technologies with big data. And I want to be really clear about this. You cannot be a digital expert if the core of your business is in a host. That is impossible. So I will try to explain how was the evolutions of the data technologies through the IT or the information technology evolution. The first data technology was this of this guy, the guy with the glasses, the host, the mainframes, and so on. And after this, we or they invented the relational databases, and then the leader became Oracle, Microsoft, and all this. But in that shift, what most of the companies really did was to complement with Oracle, with the relational databases, the previous data technology, the host. So the situation now in most of our customers, most of the 500 Fortune companies, is that they have a host, or an AES 400, and hundreds of or thousands of small Oracle mushrooms. So they didn't reduce the complexity and the cost. They increment almost by two the complexity and the cost of the companies. Then came big data. And we started to put big data lakes in the companies, because we were not brave enough to say, hey, this technology is really cool. You should replace your old previous data technology with this. So we started to put big data lakes. And again, we were doing the same mistake. We were not replacing, but complementing. Then the complexity and cost was like this. And with the big data lakes, it is like this. Now we have to manage the big data technology, the relational databases, and the old host system with the core of our company. And this is the situation of most of the companies, the big companies worldwide. So, first disruption, first recommendation, replace. This is what we are doing with most of our customers. Next year, in more than 60% of our big customers, we are trimming, we are replacing, we are starting to get out of the host, all the business core, to the big data technology and microservices and the new world. With the goal, well, the final aim is to be able to switch off the host. So replace with big data technology all previous data technologies. We are replacing Oracles, we are replacing all that technology, okay? Second disruption. Right now, most of the big digital dragons have evolved for the applications in the same way, in the same way that data. Data has moved to distributed data, and applications have moved also to distributed applications. Why or how? With microservices. You should start to deploy and to break your applications in small pieces. Why? Well, this is maybe too technical, but all the microservices are following with the Kafka, with the AMQ, this asynchronous architecture, event-driven, with the pattern reactor. These applications with the microservices and with this type of architecture delivers 10 times more performance with the same infrastructure. So this is one reason, but the real reason is this one. With microservices, you can adapt the functionality to the customers much more faster than with a monolithic application. And this is the real reason. Also, they adapt, they move, they evolve in the data centers, adapting to the use that the customers are doing at any moment. So data goes to distributed data. For us, big data, we like to simplify things. Big data is distributed data in commodity hardware that scales horizontally. If it doesn't scale horizontally, it is not big data. Oracle Exadata, is big data? No. Big machines, no. SAP HANA, is big data? They say so, of course. In our opinion, no. Why? Because the horizontality, the scale out is limited. So it is not big data, just to be very clear. So big data or distributed data in the data technology applications distributed with microservices. And of course, the third disruption is the data center operating systems. Of course, you should already be in some kind of cloud. You have to have a IaaS, infrastructure as a service, OpenStack or Open Cloud, whatever, public cloud, and a PaaS, platform as a service. But on top, with this data distribution and these microservices, application distributed, you have like hundreds or thousands of small pieces moving in your data centers. So your systems and operations engineers cannot manage all this by themselves. It is impossible because you have thousands of small pieces moving around with Docker, with Kubernetes, whatever. So you need help. And the help, in our opinion, is the resource managers. And for us, the best resource manager right now is one that is able to manage not only the big data cluster, but the data center as an entity, the whole data center. And that is the reason of the data center operating system, the DICOS. In fact, we are using MISOs. So the DICOS are able to manage all these data, distributed data microservices, and move it in a dynamic, not only elastic, but dynamic way to adapt to the use of the customers and to the needs of the company. So it is sort of machine learning or artificial intelligence to manage the data centers. Not only human, but artificial intelligence helping the system engineers, okay? So these are the three disruptions to write your own dragon. With this, we try to identify the root of, or the reason, the cause of the problem for the physical companies. And for us, this is something that has been in the market for quite a long time, several years. The reason of the problem is this application-centric. This is, in this architecture or paradigm, the applications own the data. And this is normally the situation in most of our customers. As the applications owns the data, you have, for example, the address of any customer replicated in normally more than 10 times in different applications. Of course, I have my address is in the e-commerce, is in the CRM, is in the ERP because they have to send the bill. So the data is replicated. But it is not only replicated. The data is replicated, and normally it has errors. The quality is not good. In the CRM, maybe they have my old address, and the ERP, they have the good one. So normally, it is not consistent. To solve this, we invented the informational applications, the BI, business intelligence, and we create those very good products, data marts, BI, and all that, and we really need them. And then with big data, you can, that data mart or that data warehouse, okay, delete that and put big data lake. If we put a big data lake there, we are not solving the problem. In fact, we are multiplying by two the problem, because we have data replicated there up, and then we are moving that data to the data warehouse or the big data lake, and we have replicated the data again. And in fact, the biggest problem is that, where is your customer? Your customer is there, in contact with the operational applications. And where is the intelligence of the company? The intelligence, the data intelligence, is there. So it is far, not only in distance, but in time. Normally, the intelligence is day minus one day behind, 1 week, or 1 month. Because you are generating dashboards, and then the dashboard go to the board, they take decisions, and then they go to operations and go to the customer. So this is really a big, big problem. So what is the solution? Because a big data lake, okay, it is really cool, it solves a lot of things, but doesn't solve this problem. So these were the problems, or the real problem that we have in the companies. No real time. If you create a very good big data lake and you move the data very fast, you can be near real time, but you cannot be real time. Maybe near, but not real. And of course, partial intelligence. So what is the solution? Well, the solution has been in the market for quite a long time, just talking about a concept. The concept was data-centric. In the data-centric, the data own the applications. It is just all the way around. So the data is unique at the center, and all applications are using the same data. When an application is using or wants to use my address, it will go to the data center and will take my address. But if the call center wants to use the address, it will go to the data center and will get the same data. So it is always synchronized, and it is not replicated, and it is real time. In fact, here, in a data-centric approach, you don't have operational and informational. In fact, in the operations, in all the digital channels and the physical channels, you have the intelligence of the data, because the intelligence is in the same cluster where the data is, where the data is created, and where the data chain. So the intelligence is also provided by an API of data intelligence that gets, for example, the micro-segmentation from the cluster. So in this way, you have the access to the data with an API, data as a service, with microservices moving around to access the data. Then you have another API to access the intelligence of the data, all the machine learning algorithms that are inside the cluster, the big data lake, are accessible through those data intelligence microservices. And in this way, we have the informational and operational applications together in a single point. In fact, they don't exist any longer, because data intelligence is part of the operational applications, okay? I think this is a lot of information. The questions you can ask, whatever you want. So the advantage is, of course, here you have real time, because as soon as a data is created or it is modified, the machine learning and the algorithms that are running there in the cluster will update. So you really have real time. And it is the only way to have real time. Of course, you have maximum data intelligence, no more silos. And I am going to explain how this solves the digital transformation. So at the beginning I said, digital transformation is just three things. The first, customer centricity obsession. Second, digital channels, prioritizing mobile. And the third, data intelligence. For the customer centricity, the good the best news about the data-centric approach is that by design, you have solved the customer centricity, the omnichannel, the customer 360. Because if you have all your data in a single point, all the data of the company, you have already created the customer 360. In fact, you don't have to move data from other systems to ingest the data in your customer lake to have the data. It is already created there, and it is modified there. So you have it in real time. So with the data-centric, you have solved the customer centricity. For example, omnichannel. Omnichannel is key for digital transformation. Here, if you change if a customer call to the call center and change or has any complaint, all the digital channels will have access to the same data and to the complaint and to the point where the customer was. So if he calls or go to a physical channel, that physical channel will have the same data that he was complaining about in the call center call. So the omnichannel is also solved by design. So customer centricity obsession is solved here by design when you have all the data in the same point, at the same point. And of course, digital channels. Digital channels, I say, it is not about nice interfaces. It is not about user experience. Of course, it is part, but it is not only that. Here we talk about behavior analytics. If you are able to store from the digital channels and the physical channels all the behavior of your customers in the data-centric, you can analyze that, you can be smart, you can adapt. So you can see there the web apps and the mobile apps. You can do customization, recommendations, analyzing and taking into account the customer behavior. And that is the only way to have really thrilling digital channels, exceptional digital channels and physical channels. So the second vector, the best way really to solve it, in our opinion, the only way is to have this behavior analytics, this adaptation, continuous adaptation and evolution with the customer. Only if you have all the data of your customers, all the behavior, everything that they do in the website, in the mobile apps, in any place, in a single point with intelligence, that is the only way to do it, okay? And the third vector was data intelligence, and this is data intelligence by itself. So with a concept that has been around for some years, we have solved the three vectors of the digital transformation. And that is the reason we say that big data is the best way to do the digital transformation. In fact, for us, it's the only way. If you don't have big data, at least data intelligence, you will not be able to do it. Because, okay, at the end, if you have the data intelligence with operations and with your customers, you become a data intelligence company. So, how have we done this? We have used, because I was talking about a concept before, we move from another resources managers to MISOs last year, and we rebuilt our platform from scratch. We are using only the DCOS with MISOS, Marathon, and all the ecosystem to build all the big data stack on top. But in order to be data-centric, another thing that we had to do was to incorporate different data stores in the data-centric product. Why? Because we are not talking here, and I insist, we don't solve analytic problems. We solve operational problems, operational applications. We solve both, but we come from the operational side, okay? So, in order to do an operational applications, you cannot use HDFS. Trust me. You cannot use HDFS to solve your e-commerce channel, your mobile app, or whatever. Of course, you can't. So we incorporated different data stores. In fact, we think that with 5 or 6, we will continue incorporating some of them. But with 4 or 5, you can solve most of the use cases that you have in a company, operational and analytics. So the first one was, of course, SDFS plus Parquet, because it was natural. And for analytics and some use cases, it is the best one. The second was to incorporate into Mesos a distributed Postgres with a Spark layer to unify the nodes to be able to solve all the use cases where you needed transactional operations. Because here we are talking about operational applications. So here, in the data center, we have an ACID, a transactional data store, inside Mesos. Okay, and Mesos is getting the everything for the distribution of data and the high availability and all that. And this was necessary. And then, of course, Cassandra. Why Cassandra? Because when you have machine data, sensors, IoT, and all that, for us, Cassandra is one of the best solutions. Postgres is not enough, of course, although our Postgres is distributed and we are using this Postgres to manage almost hundreds of terabytes. When you are in the petabytes, an ACID transactional data store is not good enough. Cassandra was the solution. In fact, we combined Cassandra with Lucene indexes to solve some very specific use cases. So Cassandra was the other one, and of course Elastic. Why Elastic? Because Elastic, if you want to search for words and for unstructured data, it is the best solution, but also is moving Elasticsearch to the document-oriented databases, and so it was an intersection between Elastic and MongoDB and all other databases. And it was easy to incorporate Elastic or to improve it inside the Mesos ecosystem. So to be really a data-centric product to solve the data-centric, you need to have multiple data stores inside. But to have the data unified, we built a fusion layer on top, a data fusion layer. It is called CrossData, and we use Spark and Spark SQL to do the queries and to do the operations with the different data stores. Why? Because for the applications, it should be easy to develop or to migrate any application. So this CrossData is doing an SQL interface that is able to do joins between the different data stores that are beneath, that are behind. So we can make a join between data that is in Cassandra with data that is in HDFS or data that is in the Postgres or whatever. And it will be completely transparent for the application or for the developer. And of course, the CrossData is the interface, JDBC and ODBC to all the business intelligent applications, because you will need to do reporting, dashboards, and all this stuff. So this was the solution, and we are transforming some of the biggest banks, telecom, insurance, and retail companies in the world completely with this product to digital transformation ground level in less than 3 years. I know that some of you will be thinking, OK, this is too good to be true. So I think at 2:45, you have a demonstration of the product in our stand, and you can go deep and touch it and see how Mesos is managing Spark and Cassandra and the Postgres, and how the machine learning is working inside these operational layers. OK? Well, how to do it? Because this sounds like Big Bang. I am going to replace all data technology in my company. It is very risky. So the way to do it is to have a strategic vision, but execute it step by step with small tactics steps. So it is something like this. You start creating the new applications, of course, in the data-centric, and moving little by little your old data technology to this big data approach. And then after 3 years, you will be able to have most of your operations. For example, first ones are the customer 360, the digital channels, and the marketing. Digital marketing should be there from the very beginning, first year. And then second and third year to go to this cost trimming and switching off the core banking, the core retail, or whatever you have in the host. And then at the end, you will not be able to move everything, because there are products that work with previous data technology. It is OK. You need a very, very fast ingestion layer there to get the data from those. But most of your operations and intelligence will be there. So you will get the real value of big data and the real value of the technology. In fact, for us, is key Kafka. Kafka is part of the AMQ architecture and is asynchronous, event-oriented. And for example, in some of the customers, we have integrated Kafka inside the host to get the data from the host as fast as we can until we replace the host. For example, Iñaki Bernal was explaining that yesterday about BBVA. The Kafka is already in the host. So this is the way to do it. And I want to just end my presentation with this, to be more apocalyptic. And this is Daenerys Targaryen. Game of Thrones is my favorite series. So they can live in my new world or die in their old age. So thank you. Some questions?
There's a slide here, maybe for the questions. All right, thank you very much, Oscar. Any questions, please? Right, over there, like the sixth row, do we have a microphone? Okay, please say your name and the question. Yeah. Yes,
Jordi Masramon from Cumbram. And the question is, I love this idea of having data centricity and don't replicate data. I think this is one of the pains I have always seen in big data technologies nowadays. But this is not mature enough from a technological point of view. And actually, you contradict yourself when you explain what you're using, because you're integrating different data technologies in your system.
Yep.
So isn't indexing in Elasticsearch replicating data?
Yeah, very good question. In fact, we only have 45 minutes, so it was very difficult to explain something as complex as the concept and the technology behind in 45 minutes. But in big data, we are talking about distributed data. So the data, of course, is replicated. That is the reason in big data we have high availability and fault tolerance. So in fact, you can choose how many times normally you will replicate the data in the data storage. For example, in Cassandra, normally, or HDFS, it is 3 times. And then the data is replicated, but it is physically replicated because we need high availability and fault tolerance, but logically, it is single, it is unique. And it is synchronized, everything is synchronized to make that data unique to the applications and to the company. And that concept, the same concept of data replication in big data, is the one that we are using for the different data stores. If you are using different data stores and you are using Elasticsearch with Cassandra, for example, for IoT, because the TCP/IP packages, we are indexing than in Elasticsearch, but the data, the stored data is not in Elasticsearch because it will grow too much and it will be too slow. We are in storing the stored TCP IP packages inside Cassandra. But when you do it in an automatic way, so they are synchronized. So if you look for an IP in Elasticsearch, when you get that IP, automatically you will have all the packages from Cassandra where that IP was related. So with CrossData and the technology that we have built, although the data is replicated in the different data stores, to the applications and to the company, will look and will be managed like a single entity and not replicated. And the real answer is, you will replicate the data, but it will be your decision, under your control, because there is value in that replication, not because it was a mistake, okay? In fact, just to show some of the complexity of the product, here we are trying to show some of the technologies that we are using. As I explained, in the third IT generation, or this Dragon technology, you need a data center operating system. And the data center operating system allows you to put this data centric in any type of infrastructure that you have. You can install this in bare metal. You can install it, the DCOS, using OpenStack in a private cloud in your company. You can use it on top of any cloud, Amazon or Google, and you can combine in a hybrid cloud the data-centric product, and the DCOS will manage that. So there you can see the different modules and solutions that we are using to be able to achieve such a huge goal. We are using the DCOS and Mesos for the data center operating system. For service orchestration, we are using Marathon. For service discovery, Consul. The containers, of course, Docker. There are some technology container technology around, but Docker is the standard. Node provisioning, we are using Ansible and Terraform. So as you can see, there are a lot of different pieces to be able to build the first data-centric product in the market. In fact, 2 years ago, it would have been completely impossible to build this data-centric product. The data-centric was only a concept until 2 years ago. Up to our understanding, we think that this is the only solution for the data-centric concept. And then on top of the DCOS, the data center operating system, you have Kafka as the bus for the data with this asynchronous events-oriented philosophy that cross everything, Zookeeper for the metadata and some of the high availability. And then on top, you can see the different data stores that I was talking about, a distributed Postgres, Cassandra plus Lucene indexes together, Elasticsearch, HDFS. And then there you can see the fast data processing with Spark Streaming, a CEP engine, complex event processing, because for IoT or machine data, it is better to manage that with a complex event processing or a business rule engine with rules. And then on top you have cross data, the fusion layer with Spark SQL, working there, and then you can manage all the different data stores and all the systems with Strato Intelligence to implement with Jupyter or RStudio or most of the machine learning libraries that are in the market. And you can build your apps. So as you can see, well, in the right you have the governability and security issues, and we are using Vault, Kerberos, and other technologies that cross all the platform to do data-centric enterprise-grade product. So you need different and very complex technologies to integrate that and to have a manager on top of this to be able to solve such a big problem in the companies in a really excellent way. Anyway, if you have any question in how we are using Mesos or Spark or how we are solving this data, distributed data on top of Mesos and how mature it is, in our stand we will answer any question. So, any other question? Hola.
Hola. Hola. Hola, soy Christian de I am Christian from Logitravel and I would to know your opinion about Apex and Flink that are technologies compared to Spark. Thanks.
Well, for us Spark, as you can see, is quite core to our products. We think that Hadoop has evolved. Hive is a very good product. In most cases, Hive is as fast or as good as could be a Spark, and it depends on the queries. And so this is really complex. It is the same for Impala. Impala is an interactive SQL engine, and it is also, of course, a good product. For us, we don't recommend Impala because it is although the product is open, there are no several companies behind or it's not in the Apache Foundation, so you will have locking if you are using Impala, so we don't recommend Impala. But between Spark, Hadoop, Hive, or for the fast data processing engines, you have options. Flink is a very good one. We really like Flink. The concept is, in some aspects, better than the Spark streaming concept because you are not micro-batching the data. So yes, we like those technologies. In fact, in the future, we will incorporate to the Stratos Sparta module. Probably the next one will be Flink. But in our opinion, they are still not mature enough. They don't have enough use cases or companies or projects in production, so they don't have the maturity of Spark and Spark Streaming. And we use and choose Spark because with Spark you simplify because you have the batch, the interactive, and the streaming, the fast data processing in one single framework. So it was much easier for us and for the developers to do things. But of course, in the future, we will incorporate things inside because the market is evolving and it is part of our mission to simplify the technology in the state of the art at any moment.
I don't think we have time for questions. Thank you very much, Oscar and everyone.
Thank you.